Next week, we have a lot of things that going on that you can invite people to. Good Friday service up here at 7 o'clock, obviously on Friday evening. Then Saturday and Sunday, we'll have the exact same services, but Saturday you have a chance up here at 5 o'clock, and then Sunday's just the normal time. There's two services down at Oak Bridge City on Sunday morning at 8, 15, and 10. So invite people. All the stats show that this would be the time of the year when people would say yes, and you know, we believe that what takes place here and throughout churches all over the world on Sunday mornings and whenever people gather together is we share the greatest message ever, the message that changes lives, that changes eternal destiny. So, again, you might just be thinking that you'll invite somebody to church and they'll have a cup of coffee with you, but it might change future for generations. So I invite you to do that and invite you to invite people. It's a big deal. Big deal. So I'm Herc Knoblett, and thank you there. I don't know where Dan's at, but somebody took up the slack. So one of the pastors here, and if you're visiting with us today, we're glad that you're here. We'd love for you to stop by the information desk, or there's a room right across the hallway called the Connect Room. They'll give you a packet on the church, answer any questions you might have, show you around, and they'll also hook you up with a t-shirt for you and anybody else that's with you. So we'd love for you to do that. A couple of announcements specifically for newcomers. One is we're not taking an offering this morning, so we want you to sit back, just enjoy the service, connect with Christ in some way, whether it's this song, the message, some element of the morning. We'd love for you to do that. If Oak Bridge is your home, you guys know where the joy boxes are at, and if you can give because you believe in the mission of Jesus Christ and his church, then go ahead and do so accordingly. And then this morning, we won't be taking communion together, but there's a room right behind this wall. You can go through the bookstore called the Reflection Room. You can go in there and reflect upon why we're here, because we have a God that's so amazing, that loves us so much that he sent his one and only son to die for us so that our sins would be forgiven, so we'd be restored and in relationship with God. So you can go back there and remember that in a special way. Then also, I'd encourage everybody to go back there and you can write out prayers. And we have a prayer team that prays all week long over those things. And, you know, we believe that prayer is powerful and effective. It actually changes things. So take advantage of that. People will pray with you this morning if you want. But just a good place to go back and just kind of relax. Again, I mentioned the services this week. Tonight, we have The Edge. That's for our seventh graders all the way up through 12th graders. And they come and just have a great time in here, play some crazy games. They have a worship service. My son Josh gives the message, and they talk in small groups about that thing. So I would encourage you, if you've got students, to bring them. We finish up tonight. There's a senior series. So our seniors in high school actually put the thing together and kind of gave Josh the message and all that, so you could come and support them. And then we looked through all the signups. We've got our summer programs that's signing up for, and that is for our Big Stuff Camp. And from 6th grade through 12th grade, so current 6th graders, ones that are going into 7th, all the way up through seniors in high school are eligible to go. And looked, and we're down to 21 spots. So if you haven't signed your kids up yet, then we'd encourage you to do that. And then also not obviously next weekend, but the weekend after that, we've got our men's breakfast on Saturday morning, the 15th. I think, Tom, did I miss anything? Oak Bridge Online. Yeah, you guys can welcome the people that are watching online, Oak Bridge. So, you know, we're going to have the band lead us in just a moment. But before we do that, traditionally in the church calendar, this is known as Palm Sunday. And so that would be where Jesus was riding into Jerusalem on a donkey to fulfill the scripture that the king would be riding in. And you know, the people missed it. They were all yelling out hallelujah and waving palm branches. But I think that they were doing it for a different reason. They thought Jesus was going to lead this military revolution, this revolt. They were going to overthrow Rome. And I guess what I would say is it was weird in how fickle the crowds were, because on that day they're yelling hallelujah, and less than a week later they're yelling out crucify him. And so I would say the challenge this morning, and maybe all this week, and I'd encourage all of you to get into the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, read the last few chapters of each of the Gospels, and you'll get the story of this Passion Week. But, you know, those people created God and had an image of God that was from their own expectations. And when we read the scriptures, and we see the amazing plan that God has and how Jesus fulfilled that in a way that we would have never dreamed, it can change things. So I'd encourage you maybe take some time this week and really reflect on that. And I'm going to say a prayer here in a moment, but I want to give you guys just a few moments to prepare your hearts. We've got a great service plan, great worship, continue on in the book of James, but just go to God on your own for a few moments. Father in heaven, you're a good God, and we acknowledge that your name is like no other, that you alone deserve all praise, all worship, that you have no rival, that you have no equal, Father, that everything that you do is right and true and just and loving. We thank you for that. So I pray this morning that our attention is focused upon you, giving you the praise that you alone deserve as we sing and as we worship together in Christ's name. Amen. Chuck, you want them up? Tom, you do it.
Hey, 250 years ago, a hymn was written by a guy named John Newton, and it was year 1772, and the hymn was called Amazing Grace. Now, I would have to guess, people have asked, what's been the most popular song probably sang in all Christian churches in the last couple hundred years? I would have to say it's been Amazing Grace. Wouldn't you say that as well? It's a song that is actually powerful lyrics. It's actually incredibly biblical in what it said. Before we took over Oak Ridge City, if you've ever been to that church down there, it's a gorgeous church. And before we decided to buy it, I was in there and they had a pipe organ. And there was a lady there and she played the pipe organ and she knew the building was closing. She knew that another church was buying it. And I came in and I said, could you do me a favor? Could you play Amazing Grace? And I thought in my mind, as I'm sat in there, there's nobody else in the building. She's just there. I'm sure she was grieving the fact that she had played that pipe organ for many years, that wasn't going to happen anymore. And so in the quiet of the building, she played Amazing Grace. And it was a holy moment because I knew the lyrics. So I want to just read a few of the lyrics to you guys, read a couple of the Bible verses where I believe John Newton pulled these lyrics from. And then my prayer this morning is that this song means something to you because God's speaking to your heart. And he's saying, look, I know you, I love you, and my grace is for you. Here's verse 1 of Amazing Grace. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Romans 7:24 said, what a wretched man I am. Who will rescue me from this body that is subject to death? Luke 15:24 says, for the son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. So they began to celebrate. I think John Newton knew both those verses. The prodigal son, I think he knew certainly about a wretched man that he is and that who's going to save him. Verse 2, 'twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. In Ephesians 2:7 it says, in order that in the coming ages, that's our time, he might show, that's Jesus, the incomparable riches of his grace expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus, that we may know the grace of God through the life of Jesus Christ. Verse 3, the Lord has promised good to me. His word my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life endures. Ephesians 2:4 says, but because of his great for us, God is rich in mercy. Verse 4, through many dangers, toils, and snares, I have already come. 'Tis grace hath brought me safe this far, and grace will lead me home. Romans 8:28. And we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. In the final verse, before Billy plays his saxophone to this song for us, when we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we've no less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun. Billy. Thank you. Father, we go to you and we praise you. We thank you. We thank you that this hymn, this song, echoes back to you the truth of the word that you gave us 2,000 and 3,000 years ago. Father, we praise you for the fact that your grace is amazing, that it does save us, that we can sing to you in praise of your Son, Jesus, in praise of your creation, in praise that you are faithful and that you're for us and that Jesus is always the proof. God, touch the heart of the one in here today, or watching online, or in the foyer, in the building, who just needs to understand, needs to feel, needs to experience one more touch of that grace to know that they're loved by you. God, we love you. We sing these praises to you. It is in Jesus' name that we sing, in Jesus' name that we pray. And all God's people said, amen. Let's stand and sing to God.
Strong and I've been broken within a moment. I've been faithful and I've been reckless in every bend. I've held everything together and watched it shatter. I stood tall and I have crumbled in the same. I have wrestled and I have trampled towards surrender. Chased my heart adrift and drifted home again. Plundered blessings till I've been desperate to find redemption. Every time I turn, somebody you still want. So
If you're needing forgiveness or healing, His mercy is enough. Oh, and this is our hope. The cross, it is spoken. Death is no more. Christ is the Lord. This is our
guys can have a seat. You know, Tom, I'm sure you guys have heard him say that we always need to keep one eye on earth and one eye on heaven. And that's because as crazy as this world is that we live in, we're here for a blip of time. Someday we will spend eternity with Jesus. There's a lot of scripture in the Bible that tries to explain to us what heaven looks like or what it may be like, and I don't think any of them can do it justice. I don't think we can imagine what it's going to be like. We've all lost somebody, just sickness, cancer, you name it. But one day, we'll be in heaven with them and they won't be sick. So, if you guys will just enjoy this song and think about imagining what heaven's going to be like.
Imagine it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Yeah. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in all of you be still? Will I stand in your presence? To my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. Only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I will do is forever worship you. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in all of you be still? Will I stand in your presence? To my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only
God, we just come to you, and we know that you're preparing a place for us, and there's no way that we can imagine what it looks like. But God, we know that if we are believers, that one day we will be with you, we will be reunited with all of our family, friends that we've lost. God, we thank you for that. It's because of your Son, Jesus, that we have that right. God, we thank you, and we lift your name, the name above all names today. God, we thank you.
Well, good morning. My name's Tom Abbott. I'm one of the pastors here. I was the guy that did that video that you can erase from your mind forever and ever, okay? Just so you're aware. Hey, I'll tell you a quick story. We're in James week 11. I'll tell you about James in a second. Really an important message today, a powerful message for every age and stage of life. So like if you're in here and you're 13, this is one to drill down on. And you're not going to hear this from any other place than God's word, but it's that big of a deal. I have a shower. I normally shower downstairs. Kathy showers upstairs, so I'm in the bathroom downstairs. And the shower that I've had for about the last, I guess, what is it, end of March now, March, probably starting in about September, for about the last 7 months, The shower head would hardly put out any water. I would get out of the shower and half of my body would be dry. I mean, you get what I mean? It was just trickling come down. It was a frustrating experience. There was hardly no water coming out of the thing, and it would take 3 minutes for the thing to warm up. So, you know, you'd turn the water on, and it's just a frustrating thing. And I didn't know what happened to it. So you get in the shower, and like I said, it's just, you normally look forward to a shower, don't you? Warm shower in the morning. I was like dreading it, going, okay, this is puts me in a bad mood. Then I'd start to think, but the kids in Haiti, they don't even have clean water. And, you know, all the things that you should say to be grateful. And so for Christmas, my wife did the loving thing, and she bought me a new shower head. And but either because of me being lazy, me not being confident about knowing how to put it in, me not just caring that much and just saying I'm just going to tolerate it and live at this level, I hadn't put it in. And it sat downstairs right where I could see it every day, and I hadn't put it in. So not yesterday, but the day before. So Kathy goes, I put in your shower head for you. Now, she didn't really say it as a way of letting me know information. I think she said it as a way of, you lousy, lazy, you get the point. But I tell you what, I said, I got the shower this morning. And look, I'm ready to go. It is perfect. It came out. I was 10 minutes late getting here to church today. All right. I wanted to just sit there and just go, this feels so good. It's so good to be a Christian in America today. Warm, beautiful. You know, that's most of you Christians with your faith. You allow yourself to sit in a faucet that has hardly any warm water, and you endure it when James says there's a faith that works, yet you want to live in that station of life when there's a full flood of life that you can live. That's really what James is saying all along this. That's why this whole book of James is so important. When he talks about trials in life, how you perceive trials, when he talks about the words you use, when he talks about the wisdom you apply, he says you as a Christian have so many advantages over people that don't know Jesus, that don't know his word, and yet you choose not to apply this faith. You choose at times for it to just be lip service. If you're young in here today and you say, well, I've seen some Christians and I wouldn't want to follow their life, I'm not asking you to follow their life. Young people, listen, I'm asking you to follow the life of Jesus, and you do your life with Jesus. That's the right way. And for all of us in here, it's a wake-up call. The book of James is a loving wake-up call to say, live the abundant life, the full life that Jesus has for you, and be a light in your world, in your community, in your family. You can do this. I've equipped you. I've even sent a Holy Spirit to comfort and convict you. You can do this. This is today one of those messages that is timely, spot on to the culture we live in, and yet powerfully true for all of us that are Christ followers. We can get, we can run away from this faith and you run into that little water that's spitting out some water that's cold. Or we can run into this truth today that's full force, that just feels good, that is right. That's where I'm asking you to go. So last week, we mentioned two types of wisdom, that there's really only two types of wisdom. One is heaven down, God's word, God's bringing down. And that heaven down wisdom, it's not sinful, it's pure. Scripture says it's peace-loving, it's merciful, it shows good fruit, more love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, and self-control. It's of God. And then there's another wisdom that's called hell-up wisdom. And it's wisdom that sometimes seems right, but realistically, it's not. And it leads to bitterness. The Bible says bitter envy and selfish ambition. It always leads, this hell-up wisdom will always lead to, you'll find some form of bitterness, some form of selfishness, and that's where it goes. So if you're saying right now, why my life feels a little bitter, my family feels a little bitter, then you've probably been leaning into hell-up wisdom, and you don't have to do that. God's word is fully for us there. I want to give you an example of this heaven-down, hell-up wisdom. And this is kind of where James is going to go today. I'm not going to get into James chapter 4. I think we go verses 1 through 8 or 1 through 12. I'm not sure which we're going to get to today. I'm not going to get to it till about the middle of the message because I want to set it up for you where you can fully understand what he's saying. But here's an example I'm going to use of parenting of heaven-down wisdom versus hell-up wisdom. The good parent teaches values. You teach your children values. Honesty, generosity, kindness, respect, so forth and so on. I was with the grandkids this week, and I remember reminding one of them, well, sharing is caring. Any parents have ever said that? Well, sharing is caring. It's right. If you care for your brother, you care for your sister, sharing is caring. It's a good thing to do. When you have children, and they're playing with toys with other children, and your child, which I'll back one up, you have to teach your children almost everything, how to eat, how to walk, when to speak. Correct? Yes? Get along with me. Yes? Do you have to teach them how to be selfish? Hey, Johnny, when she comes over and she has to play with that toy, you go, no, mine. You've never had to teach that, do you? All right? So there's some things that you know you're teaching values to overcome the natural things, right or wrong, that some of us do. So if kids come over and they play with toys and one kid says, no, he can't play with my superhero, you say, no, let him play with it for 5 minutes. He can't watch the phone. No, you get 5 minutes, she gets 5 minutes. All the deal, you got that. Eating cookies, got a little bag of Famous Amos cookies, got them from Oak Ridge. You're not teaching your kid not to share their cookies with other kids, right? You're teaching them to share, of course, because that's a value. Generosity is a value. But you don't look at the little kid who says it's my toy and go, Johnny, it's okay. You do you. That's how you are, little guy. All right? You love all the superheroes. Nobody else gets to play with your superheroes. Melanie, you do you. Eat all the cookies. They don't need any cookies. If their parents really loved them, they'd give them cookies. Right? You don't do that. You never tell your kids, you do you. Right? Am I right? You know, I mean, when would you say that to him? Well, I'm disrespectful. I'm 16. I'm disrespectful. That's okay. You do you, sweetheart. I'll still give you the car and fill up the gas. And when you come home, I'll have dinner for you right there. You do you. You don't say that. Correct? All right. If you're dating somebody and they have that attitude, you do you, I do me. That's it. I just do me. You're not going to date very long. If you marry that person, trust me, that's not the marriage you want to enter. That's not the relationship that you want to make permanent. You do you plays on selfishness and bitterness. See, when you do you, you become more selfish. When you do you, it's as if you're saying to everybody else, look, that's your problem, your thing. I do me. It's bitter. That's what it is. And you know that. You do you has no guardrails. Values are guardrails. When you have somebody that, at our church, we have 10 values that are out in the hallway. Family, authenticity, the Bible, you can go through them all. Those are our guardrails. If it looks like that we're going left to right, if it looks like we're just coming to a social club or quote-unquote a political organization, that's not anything we want to be about. We go to the guardrails and say, here's our guardrails. It's the Bible. Here's where we're at. Guardrails are values. You do you has no values, has no guardrails. It's whatever you think you do, that's what you're supposed to do. That there's no guardrails in that situation. It leads to destructive patterns. It leads to destructive behaviors. That's what you do you does. One more example of it. So for me, I've always been highly competitive. Okay? And I've noticed some people that as I've gone through life, some of you are very competitive. Some of you could care less about competition. Okay? And it doesn't mean that you don't care about doing things right. I am highly competitive. Is there anybody else in this room that is just highly competitive? Okay. Why play a game if you're not going to keep score? Right? That it's a problem with me playing pickleball. Okay? This pickleball seems like, hit the ball over, set it up. I mean, if you've ever played pickleball, it's hard for me because I want to smash the ball. I'm not right. Okay? I'm not right in this. I'm wrong. I'm letting you know that. All right? When I smash the ball against my wife on the other side of the net, it's not right, all right? So I'm highly competitive, and I realize that. Winning and losing is obsessive with me. And I'm not a good winner because I like to talk about winning. So I've said this story, but if you're new here, I want to kind of give it to you. My son Matt, who's now 31, when he was probably 8 or 9, we're out in my backyard. I have a basketball court in my backyard, and we were playing hockey, and he played roller hockey at that time period. I was walking around, and he's on rollerblades as an 8 or 9 year old, and we had a little net, and I would score. So, little 8 or 9 year old, and score. I say, "You can't stop me." Score. Matt would get the ball, steal from me, and go, "Woo, you see Dad do that?" Now I have tennis shoes. He's rollerblading. He's 8. And I'm 40. And I'm talking trash to him. Matt stops in the middle with you could almost see the start of a tear, and says, "Dad, why are you saying that? Why do you talk like that?" And I realized that I was just joking around. For me, it's no big deal. Somebody would talk that way. But for him, he was just playing with his dad in the backyard. And I turned it into some form of competition. Could I put it up the right corner on you? Could I put it in the left corner on you? So at that point, I realized if my thought is me do me, if that's my thought, I'm going to ruin this relationship with my son, whom I love. So it was weird, about 20, 25 years ago, I just decided at that point to quit competing in everything. I wasn't going to compete in sports. I didn't like Herc and I, you know, I love my brother Herc. We've had some massive fights. I mean, fights as adults. I mean, he tore one of my best shirts ever. You'd say, "Well, look, there's our pastors fighting." Now, it hasn't happened in about 25 years. You know why? I quit competing. See, me doing me wasn't good. That wasn't right. It hurt relationships. I realized competition mode, I was the problem. Not competition, I was the problem. So I made the decision, if I can't stop it, I'm not going to do it. And even today, I have to watch it. When we go play pickleball down at Oak Ridge City, there's a group of people. If you want to play pickleball, let me know. There's a group of people that have pickleball, people that go down there. But I gotta watch it. I got to be careful. I got to stop at times. They'll ask, "Well, why don't you want to play more pickleball games?" I do, but I can't, because I don't like who I am or where I feel like or where I'm going. Got it? You do you's dangerous. Me do me's dangerous. I'm trying to hammer this home, because when I read this, it's really powerful reading, but you got to get this. We have this at the start of March Madness. My older brother Steve, my younger brother Herc, Josh, who's my nephew, Herc's son, pastors Oak Ridge City, all great people, and eight other people get together, and we have this March Madness pool. We come up here and we draft. We draft players. So without going on a long team, you draft 12 players. Whatever those players score, how they score, that's what the guy that gets the most points at the end of the tournament, if your guy scores 12 points in a game, you get 12. So you're trying to pick the winners, and you're trying to pick players from the teams, and you win. Well, I've told you that I'm competitive, and I've told you that I talk. So in all these, I'm the only two-time winner, the multiple winner of this tournament in all the time that we've done it. Okay, I'm the only one. So I send out a little newsletter of encouraging, trying to teach them the right strategy. So this year, as of before yesterday, I was in first. And all the other people who are Oak Ridge people, much more mature Christians than I am, said, "There is no way Tom can win this. We will never hear the end of it." In fact, I had thought of a motto I'd told Herc, 34 and 24. I'm 3 straight going for 4. In 24. I had a motto set up for me to win this thing. Now, this is what's sick as I move into this. We all throw in $25. If you're against gambling, sorry. All right. I'm not getting bankrupt on it, just so you know that. So the winner gets 200, second place gets 75. I didn't even care about the money. You could take all the money, give it to charity, give it to whatever you want. I just wanted bragging rights. So right when it hits me, I'm thinking, "Tom, you're doing it again. Just surprise everybody and show some humility. Don't say anything." I said a lot. Last night, all my teams got eliminated, and I cannot win. I I lost last night, but I think I won. Because I was going to do me. Instead, humility wins the day. You do you at 15, and you'll regret it. You have your dad do you. I mean, he does himself, and this is all he cares about and what he wants. You'll have a dad that you won't have respect for. You do you is the cry of our culture today. You do you can lead to some messed up values and some messed up lives. That's a true statement. Philippians 2, 3 through 4. The only way to keep you, by the way, from doing you is to have humility. A humility. It's an important thing. It's a word that won't be talked about much in culture. Pride will be talked about. Amen? But not humility. And I'm not even talking about the cause. I'm talking about the value of the word. Philippians 2, 3 through 4. Do nothing out of selfish ambition. This is Paul speaking to a group of Christians in this area called Philippi. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. That's hell up wisdom. Selfishness, vain conceit. He says, do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interest, but each of you to the interest of others. Have the same mindset, the next line, which you won't see, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus. God above came as a humble person. We're Christ followers. This letter to James is written to Christians. If you're not a Christian here today, you have a free pass. You can listen in and say, yeah, if most Christians applied that, James, I would consider greatly becoming one, but I don't see many of them that do it. That's what we're going to try and change with this teaching for all of us. And some of you maybe have, and I applaud you, and way to go. So this value of humility is really where James talks about. And it's why I love Oak Ridge Kids, because I'm going back to the, that you don't, hell up teaches you do you. Heaven down teaches values. I love Oak Ridge Kids because if you don't know it or not, they teach 12 values a year. They take 4 weeks, 1 month, and they'll teach a value. And they'll drill that down with kids with Bible verses and see how it's applied. And they'll teach it in different areas, and their crafts will go along with it. And their take-home teachings will go along with it. And the scriptures, all age appropriate, but they have values. Why? Because that's a better way to live. It's a smart way. They live values. Some of the values that they've taught them is sharing, honesty, compassion, patience, gratitude, respect. All the things that you would want to have your kids to know, they teach it and say, well, this is why God says it's a good thing. Unbelievably, I'm getting to James chapter 4. I didn't have any of this planned out. I was happening to be at church yesterday, walking around. I said, I wonder what this month's value is for April. Here's what the value is for April. Humility. They defined it, humility is putting others first by giving up what you think you deserve. Their memory verse was Philippians 2, 3, the one I just read to you. Now, again, I don't know what the odds are that I'm going to speak on humility. I don't know that now for 4 weeks ago, and they're going to. All I know is this. God wants somebody in here, somebody online, somebody in the foyer, to humble themselves before him and to quit doing you do you. Because you have children, you have family, you have people that you don't know what you're doing to. You don't know what relationships you're severing. And even more than that, it'll be better for your self-esteem. That's why I love Oak Ridge Kids. They teach that. Humility is putting others first by giving up what you think you deserve. That's what they're learning right now. Putting others first by giving up what you think you deserve. What a way to live. Don't you like that? Just by a round of applause, don't you like that? Don't you like values, learning values and applying values in your life over you doing you? I mean, I like that. I like the idea of, hey, my values are my guardrails. When I do me, it may be the time that I don't like. That hurts people. So the question I want to ask you guys is, since James is going to ask it, do you pursue humility? Or is it you do you? Which is it? I want to drill down a little bit. Okay, here's 1 Peter 5 through 6. It talks about the power of humility. Here's what Peter says. In the same way, you who are younger, now listen, submit yourselves to your elders, that means those who are older, all of you, both young and old, clothe yourselves with humility toward one another. Because, and then he quotes a proverb that was written 700 years before this time period. God opposes the proud, but shows favor to the humble. In other words, God doesn't like pride. He hates it when you just do you. I don't care about you, God. You do you. He says he opposes that. He stands against that. Do you want to be against something? Do you want to be on the side where God is against it? He says, I oppose the proud, but he shows favor to the humble. And then Peter says, humble yourselves, therefore, under God's mighty hand, that he may lift you up in due time. Humility is how we relate to God and one another. Humility, using the kids' definition, which is accurate, is putting others first by giving up what you think you deserve. I'm going to call a timeout right now. 20 and down, listen to me. 19 and down. It's going to be tough for you because all culture is saying, you do you. It's everything about you. You start to think about how you can put others first and give up what you think you deserve. And you'll find character and freedom and values and influence because people will look to you for that. You'll find a better life. Humility helps us lose, now listen to this, self-obsession, self-delusionment. Humility helps us lose anxiety because it's not all about us. It helps us lose self-delusionment where we think that we're all that, we think that the world revolves around us, we think we can't live with that, we're delusional. Humility, when we think of others first, we lose that. Humility helps us gain self-awareness. Go back to my son, Matt, who played baseball. He played basketball. I coached him. And let's take from years 8 to, let's say, 13. Let's say he had a dad that competed all the time, that was on his case all the time when he made the wrong move because all he cared about was winning. Let's say that he had a dad that says, I can make the free throw. Why can't you? Watch, I'll hit 10 in a row. You won't even make 4. You tell me the relationship I would have had with my son if I did me. I remember my dad, this is a funny story, my dad was total humility. My dad would never, he did not like showboating, he did not like trash talking. I was on the other end. I can remember I went golfing with him. And he said, well, let's golf. And I said, I only want to use a 3-iron. If you're a golfer, this is the dumbest thing you can do. I only used a 3-iron the whole course. And I actually shot one of my lowest scores I've ever scored. Shot like an 83. And I was talking about this shot and chipping it up and how I did it. When we got done golfing, my dad looked at me and says, you know, that was pretty good for shooting with a 3-iron, but I really don't want to play golf with you anymore. He was right. And I said, you know what, Dad, you know why I don't enjoy golf? And he says, why? I said, because I can't talk trash during golf. It's a gentleman's game, and I'm not a what? We didn't golf. And I haven't golfed. My family's a family of golfers. Because of you do you. That's where it can lead. Now, my dad wasn't the kind to hold a grudge or anything. He understood how I was, and he understood that I was aware of how I was. I had a self-awareness because of humility. Humility is not thinking less of yourself, but thinking about yourself less. That's what humility is. Not thinking less of yourself. I know how God made me. I know how he wired me. And sometimes the things that are my greatest weakness sometimes have helped me do some things that I couldn't have done otherwise, and vice versa with you. But humility is always right. All right. You ready to study the book of James? After heaven down, hell up, James has just said, here's what James says in 4:1-3. What causes fights and quarrels among you? Do they come from your desires that battle within you? You desire but do not have, so you kill. You covet but you cannot get what you want, so you quarrel and fight. You do not have because you do not ask God. When you ask, you do not receive because you ask with wrong motives, that you may spend what you get on your pleasures. In other words, he says, you have fights and quarrels because you do you. Now, unbelievably, one paragraph, I believe it's 4 sentences, I'd have to count them again, The word you's mentioned 15 times in that passage. Your is mentioned twice. In that short paragraph, 15 you's. You do you is a recipe for relational disaster and self-esteem ruin. It is. You do you is a fight starter. Let me just say that. It's a relationship buster. It's a pride builder. It's a highway to becoming a fool. It's a wall keeping you from Jesus, and it's a door conforming you to the world. You do you teaches that there is no truth but your truth. It teaches you that you don't need anybody else and you don't need God. We have this sexuality thing going on around us. You just do you. No. It will destroy you. It has to be humility. And for Christians, it has to be submission to God. God, what is it you want? Will you help me work through this? You do you will ruin every relationship you have. It is not that. It's humility. It is thinking of others, putting their desires first. You do you always leads to bitterness, and it always leads to selfishness. I wrote this, and I'm going to say it. It's a prison for BS. For bitterness and selfishness. That's what it is. When you do you, that's what you become. And by the way, people that have that motto, this is just who I am. I'm doing me. They are bitter and they're selfish, almost without fail. I've never not seen it. I'm not saying it doesn't exist. I think there's groups of people now that are totally bitter, totally frustrated with life. Their suicide rate is high, not because people don't treat them especially the way everybody should be treated, but because it leads to bitterness and it leads to depression. You do you leads to a dead end, a small little world of bitterness and selfishness. Who wants to live in that world? But when you can think of other people, and as a Christian, when you can add the values of God, there is freedom. James 4:4-6, he keeps reading, speaking to Christians. This is us. You adulterous people, meaning you've run away from God. You've cheated on him. Don't you know that friendship with the world means enmity against God? Therefore, anyone who chooses to be a friend of the world becomes an enemy of God. In other words, when you put the values of the world or the values of God, you become on the other side of the spectrum. You're not on God's side. Or do you think Scripture says without reason that he jealously longs for the Spirit he has caused to dwell in us, but he gives us more grace? That is why Scriptures say, and he quotes this, James now quotes what Peter quoted, God opposes the proud, but shows favor to the humble. There's a time where you can humble yourself before God. I have to remember this virtually every day, and let me just, where I can put it in frame. Don't you want a pastor that wants to fight for the gospel, the good news of Jesus, yes or no? I'll use the term to be competitive. But do you want an arrogant pastor? Or do you want a humble pastor? I'll tell you this. I'm just going to throw this in because I'm running out of time. I'll make it quick. At age 28, I started a business. At age 38, the business closed. From 28 to 38, we opened 30 stores nationwide, did an average sales of about $14 million a year, had 350 people under the payroll. I thought God was building a business so I could help other people. I think God was building a business so he could humble me to eventually put me where he wanted me to be. One of the greatest things in my life was that business going under. Self-confidence, true self-confidence, is knowing that you can do anything that you put your mind to, and you can fail at everything that you can put your mind to, same way. But when God's in it, there's no loss, there's no gain, there's just faith, and you just learn. God first is always better than you first. Isaiah 66:2. 3,000 years ago. Has not my hand, this is God speaking, has not my hand made all these things? So they came into being, declares the Lord. These are the ones, this is God, these are the ones I look on with favor. Those who are humble and contrite in spirit and who tremble at my word. The words of Jesus, Matthew 10:24. The student is not above the teacher, nor a servant above his master. We're not higher than God. God's values are the highest, and they're the best values. That's why the kids are all learning those values. That's what James is trying to say. When you apply these values, you'll find freedom. You'll find relational healing. You'll find wisdom. You'll find a peace that goes beyond the world. But you got to get past you. James 4, 7 through 10. By the way, we're not in a culture war. I want you to get this. Christians, we're not in a culture war. We're in a spiritual war. We always have been. James 4, 7 through 10. Submit yourselves then to God. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. Come near to God and he will come near to you. Wash your hands, you sinners. Purify your hearts, you double-minded. Grieve, mourn, and wail. Change your laughter to mourning and your joy to gloom. Humble yourselves before the Lord and he will lift you up. Humble yourselves. Obey what he says. Do what he says. Follow his promptings, those personal promptings where you know to love somebody or say, I'm sorry, or to say you're forgiven, or to make that phone call. Go to him in prayer. Bend your knee. Confess what you've done. Say that you need him. Thank him for what he's brought. Express your confusion. Bring your hope. That's humbling yourself. I'm going to give you just a couple minutes to go before the Lord. He's with us. He's heard every word I've said. He's heard every thought you've had. He's with you for every age and stage of life, no matter how old, how young, what's going on. Go to God and ask him for humility. Ask him to get out of yourself and to get closer to him. Go to God, if you will. Father, help us to obey. Help us to live in the flow of water, not that little trinket, that little spigot that's coming out. Help us to apply your word. Our love will grow. Our wisdom will grow if we do. Our peace will grow. Help us to get past ourselves. Help us not to listen to a world that isn't preaching your values. But it's saying, you do you. It's all about you. God, that is a trap. Help us to not step into it. Help us to trust you. It's not the easiest walk, but it's the best walk. It doesn't come with the quickest questions, answers, but it's the right way to be. You'll straighten out our path, God, as we trust in you, as we quit trying to figure out everything. We thank you for your wisdom. God, I pray for the person today that just knows this was for them. This is their time. Continue to bend their knee and ask them to put others first by giving up what we think we deserve. God, I praise you and I thank you. It's in my name of Jesus that we pray. And all God's people said, amen. I'm going to ask you with one question as I get ready to close. The band's going to sing Defender. Phenomenal song. I think it's a great anthem. I think it'd be pleasing to God's ear, and I think it'd be good for our heart. But can you become self-important in your own mind? Can you? In other words, can you become prideful, egotistical? Can you? It's something to remember. Can you become self-important in your own mind? Yes or no? You know, there's an acronym for can you become self-important. You can remember this. Put it up on stage. Let's stand and sing.
I know that you've even gone
victory. Oh.
Somebody.
Two things. I hope from last week's message you're learning a proverb and you're applying heaven-down wisdom by learning God's word and memorizing it. That's one. Second thing is, I hope that's on your mind all week is how can I pursue humility? How can I pursue humility? God says that he opposes the proud, but he shows favor to the humble. The definition that Obridge Kids has is perfect. Humility is putting others first by giving up what you think you deserve. You know, I told you I was about 10 minutes late getting to church this morning because of that phenomenal shower head, right? I tried to make up the time on Telegraph Road, coming from Telegraph to Arnold. The speed limit is about 50, so that means you can go about 58, right? Speed limit's 50, I'm going about 52, 53. Get ready to hit the bridge, going across the Merrimack River. And I have to come to a slow down a lot, because there's a car in me about going 30 to 35 miles an hour. I start to get mad and angry. Come on, I'm late. I deserve to get to church on time now. I saw a handicap sticker on the car. I could tell through the window, it was a beautiful little old lady. I thought about, if that was my mom, if that was your mom, if that was your dad or your mom, would you want somebody behind them to show some humility? Would you want a Christian to show some humility to them? Yes or no? Would Jesus show humility? Humility is putting others first by giving up what you think you deserve. Let's be humble. See you next week. Thanks for coming.